comedy and action are the two genres that blend most seamlessly together. No question. It was first brewed by Buster Keaton, thrived in Hong Kong with Jackie Chan, and then this exhilarating form of storytelling peaked in about the mid-2000s worldwide. You know, we had Tropic Thunder,
I'm a lead farmer, motherfucker!
Wanted, Hot Fuzz, Black Dynamite.
I am. Motherfucker!
But when Iron Man was born in 08, the action comedy formula has since been bastardized into a chain of endless superhero movies or straight-to-streaming crap starring The Rock or Ryan Reynolds. A few have slipped through the cracks, like, you know, The Nice Guys or 21 Jump Street, but it's been a barren wasteland for our original ideas involving this combination for a long while. So I want to look back when things felt new, fun, heart-pounding, oh shit-inducing. There's many films I cherish from the peak of it all, but nothing is as original and fresh as Shoot 'Em Up. Movies find funding in many different ways, whether it be making a trailer or assembling a total pitching package with a slideshow. Michael Davis, the writer-director, decided to animate action scenes from his storyboards to showcase his enthusiastic vision. It worked very well and got him funding almost immediately. You know, when I saw the animatics after seeing the film, I could tell why. The movie is literally shot for shot what he drew. It's just a testament to how a filmmaker can materialize their dreams to the T, even with all the hurdles. His animatics were the perfect way to deliver the tone of the overall piece, because the final product is almost like an animated film itself. Our hero, Mr. Smith, played by the devilishly handsome Clive Owen, is like Bugs Bunny. He sets devious traps, delivers one-liners at all the opportune times.
Children's story, please. Oh, I know. Tell me my favorite, yeah. Tell me the one about the baby.
Maybe later, when I put you to sleep.
He even eats carrots and says, "What's up, Doc?" The whole plot is even similar to that of the episode we see being filmed at the beginning of Who Framed Roger Rabbit? The main character has to protect a baby from its environment.
I'll save you, baby!
Clive Owen's foe, Hamilton, perfectly described as a
pussy with a gun in your hand,
is played to eerie perfection by Paul Giamatti. He is the Elmer Fudd in this cartoon. Constantly thwarted by Mr. Smith, always getting the shit end of the stick.
God damn it, Smith!
There's plenty of location-based gags as well, similar to that of a Looney Tunes action sequence. Every piece of the environment is used in some way to avert capture, whether it be a table, oil, or a filing cabinet. However, what makes this not just a zany, wacky action flick is how serious the action is delivered. The director acknowledges the film's cartoonish qualities, but stresses that the focus was on making the action feel real.
Muzzle flash! Muzzle flash! Muzzle flash!
It's similar to how an actor will play a role dramatically in a comedy to make their insane actions more believable. Like Bryan Cranston in Malcolm in the Middle, or Leslie Nielsen in Airplane, Naked Gun, Scary Movie 3.
I can't believe what I just saw.
These men died for their country. Send flowers to their bitches and hoes.
This is one of the best ways to handle working with multiple genres. Keep it simple and dramatic. Everything else will come naturally.
So we're not so different after all.
Now, I've discussed a couple films so far that are total slow burns. This film is not one of them. This is a flamethrower right to the fucking face as soon as you sit down with your popcorn. Like, we are dropped right into the action as we see Mr. Smith sipping coffee and chopping down on a carrot in this extreme close-up. you know, he's sitting on a dirty bench, and there's a Dutch angle, and then he just sees a pregnant woman running by, and he sees that she's getting chased by an assassin. So, you know, he gets up, throws his coffee, and goes to the rescue.
Eat your vegetables.
You know, after that, there's rarely a moment's rest for Mr. Smith, as he's now saved the dead woman's baby and reluctantly protects it from killers throughout the film. Mr. Smith is constantly on the move, and that movement mixed with the constant location changes keeps everything going at a breakneck speed. We go from being at a warehouse, to a whorehouse, to an apartment building, a gun factory, and finally an airplane 10,000 feet in the air. You know, the cinematography always showcases these locations well and wide enough at this high speed, so we're able to actually take in all the surroundings along with our protagonist. What also helps move the film along at a lightning-fast pace, other than that, is the music. I mean, Ace of Spades by Motorhead, Joker and Thief by Wolfmother, Breathe by Nirvana, Kickstart My Heart by Motley Crue. Like, all the classic dad rock songs that used in any other capacity in any film nowadays would seem cheesy beyond belief. This soundtrack, thankfully, holds up due to its intensity and how well it matches what's seen on the screen. It makes me think of Baby Driver, how in sync that soundtrack was with the flow of the film, its editing, and the action it contains. By the end of the movie, we as an audience feel the need to just download this playlist ASAP and drive really fast down the highway as it just fucking blares through our speakers and the cops are chasing us. Michael Davis's inspiration for the film came when he first saw John Woo's Hard Boiled. During the climax, Woo's hero had to carry a baby as he shot his way through a gang-infested hospital. Davis thought, what if there was a whole movie just about that? And so, the concept of the film was born, pun intended. The simplicity of the older protagonist must protect the younger character plot structure gives Davis a lot of room to work with in terms of what happens beat by beat. Someone is gonna get shot for sure in order to save the child, but how can we keep this repeating beat fresh every time? The way they do that is through pure camp. Most films nowadays that aren't directed by Yorgos Lanthimos lack camp. You might be wondering what exactly is camp. Well, it doesn't involve any tense. It does involve risks, weaving the unbelievable with the hilarious. It's similar to how someone will laugh at something they see and say, I can't believe that happened. You know, it's going outside the box just to see how the sheltered will respond. Like, just think of any of John Waters' films.
How much is that dog in the window?
What enhances the camp in this film, in particular, is the attention to detail. Usually, something campy is a bit crude, and yes, this film certainly is that. But the specificity of its crass nature is something to marvel at. Whether it be Mr. Smith shooting the umbilical cord off a baby, killing a dozen men while skydiving, disassembling, cleaning a gun on a men's bathroom baby tray while the friggin' kid is on the floor, or murdering several men with carrots. In conclusion, I don't know how I haven't mentioned her yet, but Monica Bellucci.
And then she said the ancient phrase,